2 Corinthians chapter 10. Read the passage already. It may have sounded confusing. I hope that any confusion might be cleared up. Remember, as we go through this book of 2 Corinthians, I wanted to remind you of the overall theme of the book, which I have called the strength of weakness, which of course is a paradox, that it is through human weakness that God's strength, God's power is revealed and magnified. And that is no less the case in this 10th chapter, where there is a contrast between human wisdom and human strength versus God's wisdom and God's power. And so I've titled chapter 10, God's Work, God's Way. God's Work, God's Way. And what is happening here is, of course, that the apostle, having gained the confidence of the Corinthian church because of his utter sincerity, that encouraged him then to share in prompting them to participate in that special offering. And yet, even though the church had responded rightly to him, there were still people that were not entirely on board. In fact, some of these, they were Jewish legalists, actually, but some of them were openly opposed to the apostle. And what he does in chapter 10 is he now challenges these rebels that are questioning his apostleship. And he's not doing it just to defend himself, but he realizes that if they are not receiving his apostolic ministry, then the ministry of the Lord is being hindered. And that's really what is driving his thoughts and his words in this 10th chapter. And so the first thing that he does in this chapter is to try to correct the misunderstandings of the Corinthian church regarding the Lord's work. That is, how God's work is really done, how it's accomplished. You know, I don't know what you think, and I don't know what you believe about the work of the Lord through the local church. You may just see it as something that a pastor does, or that key people in the church do. But that's a wrong conception of the work of the Lord. And I hope that you will begin to see what it really involves. The work of the Lord in a local church like this is serious business, folks. It's not a one-man show. And it's, in fact, it's not about human beings ultimately anyway. It's about God at work in us, through us, in our midst. This, when we meet like we do today, this is a supernatural time. I don't know if you've ever viewed it like that, but this is a time that God meets with his people corporately in a very special way. Are we prepared in our thinking? Are we prepared in our hearts for a real meeting with the Lord? This is God's work. It's got to be done God's way if it's ever going to accomplish the will of God and thus glorify him. So with that in mind, let's take a moment and let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, how I ask that you will just open our eyes, open our the spiritual understanding of our spiritual hearts to the truth of the work of the Lord in believing lives, in the church like this of the Lord Jesus. May you greatly undertake, Lord, who is sufficient for these things, Paul says about the ministry of the new covenant. And of course, we would say the same thing. Our sufficiency is of you. You alone make us sufficient, because this is your work. It's got to be done your way. That is, it's got to be accomplished through your energy, through your ability, through spiritual power. And so, Lord, we pray to that end today that Christ would be glorified, that in all things, as he says, he might have the preeminence. Be preeminent in our midst. Reveal your preeminent glory to us. And I pray, Lord, all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen. So the first thing that he wants to get across regarding God's work is found in the first six verses. And join me, if you will, and note what he says in verse 3. He says, we walk in the flesh. Now, that doesn't mean that we walk in a carnal way, in a worldly way. The use of that word flesh in verse 3 means that we walk in a human body, that we're here on earth in an earthly suit called a human body. So we walk in our humanity, but he says, we do not war after the flesh. We do not, we don't wage spiritual warfare by fleshly, carnal, human means, by human wisdom and through human power. So the first thing that he wants to correct regarding misunderstanding, because these that are opposing Paul's ministry are men that are reliant upon their own personality and their own abilities. And what he says is, the opposition that I'm facing, the opposition that we face in God's work, don't misunderstand this. It's not merely human opposition. It's spiritual warfare. It's when you are working for the Lord, when you are part of God's work, you are involved in God's work, you are placed in spiritual warfare. And you are up against not mere men and women or flesh and blood, as Paul calls them elsewhere, but you are up against demonically inspired, proud people who think that they know better than others and who are unteachable in their attitude, who are unteachable in their spirit, and they are in rebellion and opposing the truth of God. The first very important truth regarding God's work is that we're all in God's work, and being in God's work means that we are waging spiritual warfare. We are in a spiritual war. Now, the accusation of these opponents of the apostle are really brought out in the first two verses. The accusation is, I, Paul, myself, verse 1, I beseech you by the meekness and the gentleness of Messiah, who I, Paul, in presence am base among you. I'm low, but being absent, I'm bold toward you. I beseech you. See that word again, two times, verses 1 and 2, the word beseech. It means to beg. He's coming to them very humbly. I beseech you that I may not be bold when I am present, with that confidence wherewith I think to be bold against some, which think of us as if we walked according to the flesh, as if we are doing God's work on the basis of human ability or human wisdom. So the accusation of these opponents of the apostle, these rebels in the Corinthian church that are led by these legalists, are simply this. The argument or the accusation is, you know, Paul, oh, he's real strong in his letters, but when he's there in person, he's a weakling. Strong in his letters, weak in person. You know what Paul does? When he says what he does in that first verse, I beg you, I beseech you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ. You know what he's doing? He's downplaying his personal authority as an apostle and his personal ability, because he doesn't want this church to depend upon him. He wants the church to depend upon the Lord. And what he's saying here is counterintuitive to human thinking. When he uses that terminology, I beg you in the meekness and gentleness of Jesus. Remember, even this morning, there was reference to Matthew chapter 11, where Jesus says, I am meek and lowly in heart. Human thinking looks down on that. We don't want meekness. We attribute meekness to a person that is non-aggressive. And so he's a weakling. He's not going to get anything done. He's not going to accomplish anything. Meekness and gentleness. Well, that's the description of Jesus. And by the way, folks, when it comes to the work of the Lord, those are key ingredients. Meekness and gentleness. He's lovingly warning these people in the church through a gentle letter so that when he does get there in person, he won't have to be harsh with them then. Gentleness. The ministry, God's work, if you will, is not about human motivation. It's about the Spirit of God moving in the heart of people. And the Lord's work, here's Paul's answer. Look at him in verse, when he says what he does in verse 3, 4, 5, and 6. We walk in the flesh, but we don't war after the flesh. What he's saying there in answer to their accusation is the ministry or God's work is not accomplished by psychological methods that you utilize in people management. It's not, you don't manipulate people's behavior by psychological mind control or control over people. That's not what God's work is about. It is all about the Spirit-empowered ministry of the Bible. The Spirit-empowered ministry of the Word of God. That's what the work of the Lord is about. And because human instrumentality or human methods, it'll never work because we're in a spiritual war. And so carnal human methods won't work. We need spiritual methods. By the way, the word war in that third verse is actually a word that means a campaign, not just one battle, but a whole bunch of battles. In other words, it is ongoing. It's not going to stop until Jesus comes for his church, for his people. And so he's saying, being in God's work puts you right smack dab in the middle of a huge satanic campaign that Satan is instigating, trying to destroy God's work. You know what we're trying to accomplish here today? When we meet together to worship the Lord, to preach God's word, did you know that there are demonic evil spirits that are seeking to destroy, to deceive, and to distract everything that God wants to accomplish right now in our time together today? I don't know. Maybe in some ways it's working. What he's saying here, it's impossible to fight a spiritual battle by relying upon human personality, human words, and human wisdom. It won't cut it. Paul says, we fight or wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against the hierarchy of evil spirits. And so human methods will never work. It's important to recognize this, folks. Satan would love nothing more than to destroy this church and any Bible-believing church for that matter. That's what he's out to do. He wants to destroy the church. He wants to destroy the truth of God, and you and I better not give him any ground by rebelling against the spiritual truth that we have in the Word of God, as well as the spiritual leadership that God has placed over us. So the answer here is, we're in a war. It's a real war. It may not be as clear, but it's a real war. It's a spiritual. And guess what? Every war has weapons. Look at verses 4 and 5. The weapons of our warfare, because it's spiritual, aren't fleshly. They're not human. But they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, to the casting down of imaginations and every high thing that would exalt itself against the knowledge of God. Our weapons are meant to bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Understand this correctly. I know that this can be applied to our own personal thinking processes, but that's not what the context is talking about here. In the context of what Paul is talking about in verses 4 and 5, is that there are mental walls of resistance whenever God's word, whenever God's truth goes forth, whenever it's preached, whenever it's taught, there are mental walls of resistance, thinking that is opposed to God's truth, that is the result of intellectual pride of some that think they know better. And those walls of resistance are supernatural. And they must then be supernaturally demolished, just like the walls of Jericho fell down supernaturally. It wasn't the Israeli army that knocked those walls down. God knocked them down from the inside out. And that's what he's talking about here. And one of the greatest weapons that we have, Paul mentioned in that first verse, it's that Christ-like humility, meekness, and gentleness. That's what God uses. One of the strongest weapons that we have is humility in God's work. Because if you remember, it is pride that plays right into the hands of Satan himself. When we have pride in our heart, that's Satan's greatest tool in our lives. Because he even says, don't put your hands quickly on any man for ministry, and don't ordain a new convert into pastoral ministry, lest being lifted up with pride, he fall into the snare of the devil. The devil's greatest tool in believing lives is our pride. We think we know better than other people in the church. We think that we have a better grasp of Scripture than other people do. Be careful. You're giving ground to the devil. You're playing into his hands. How are these spiritual walls of mental resistance broken down? I think a combination of two things. Real, believing, intercessory prayer for individuals, and Holy Spirit empowered preaching and teaching of the Word of God. I believe that unleashes the power of God and knocks down these mental walls of resistance. It's not mere apologetics. It's not your mind against the mind of those that oppose. It's the power of the Holy Spirit activated through prayer and the Word of God in our lives. That's what knocks those mental walls of resistance down and opens people's hearts to the truth of the Word of God. There's a second thing that he corrects that I think is a misunderstanding about God's work. Not only that it's about waging spiritual warfare, but where we pick it up in the 7th verse and down through the 11th verse, it's how you're using spiritual authority. This is another difficult lesson that must be learned in God's work, that your personality, your position, your ability is not the same as spiritual authority. In fact, again, this is so unlike the way the world thinks. Here's what Jesus said to his disciples when they were vying and when they were talking about who's the greatest or who will be the greatest in the kingdom. Jesus knows what's going on. And he says to them, he said, you know, they that are accounted to rule over the nations exercise lordship or dominion over them, and their great ones exercise authority upon them. But listen, it shall not be so among you. Whosoever will be great among you shall be your servant. And whosoever will be the chiefest, the greatest, shall be the servant of all. For even the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to give his life a ransom for many. Again, carnal-minded people always judge by what they see, always judge by outward appearance, but that's not the way that spiritually-minded people make their judgments. Personal power is very impressive to people that just judge on a human level. But the apostle says our real authority is used in such a way that it does not destroy people, it builds them up. Look at what he says in the seventh verse. Do you look on things after outward appearance? Do you look at a church and you say, oh, wow, you know, look at how great it looks. Wow, it must be, the blessing of God must be upon them. Well, it may or may not be so. Do you look on things after the outward? If any man trusts to himself that he is Messiah, let him himself think this again, that as he is Messiah, so are we. And then he says, for though I should boast somewhat of our authority, which the Lord's given us, he's given us that authority for edification, for building people up, and not for your destruction. What's he saying here? He's telling us that in the Lord's work, any authority, any spiritual authority that is given to a person is to be used in a beneficial way to build people up and not to destroy them. In fact, this is what the scriptures tell us in various places. In 1 Peter chapter 5, for example, Paul is talking to elders, to people that are pastors in local churches, and he says, don't be in that position so that you can lord it over, so that you can throw your spiritual authority around and have a dictatorial role that people have to fall in line to what you say. No, Paul says, instead, be an example to the flock. Lead them by your example. Lead them by your gentleness and your meekness, we might say. That's 1 Peter chapter 5. I think it's the second and third verse. So the difference between these that are taking spiritual authority from a human standpoint versus the apostles' use of his spiritual authority, the legalists, they use their authority to build up their authority, to make it even greater, whereas the apostle uses his authority to build up the church, to build up the believers. The legalists, they depended upon letters of recommendation, recommendation letters, in order to gain a foothold in the church, whereas the apostle, he relied upon the Holy Spirit of God that empowered him. The spiritually mature, they demand that we respect them, or rather, I should say, the spiritual immature demand that we respect them. But the spiritually mature, they just command respect by their leadership and by the authority that God's given them. Some have said that the immature or unspiritual, they say, go. But the spiritual authority of God say have leaders that say, let's go. In other words, I'll join you. I not only know, but I'll show you as well. And so this is Paul's call in these verses regarding using spiritual authority correctly. Look at verse 9. That I may not seem as if I would terrify you by letters, for his letters, they say, are weighty and powerful, but his bodily appearance, presence is weak. His speech, it's contemptible. Let such a one think this, that such as we are in word by letter when we're absent, if we have to, we'll be that way indeed when we're present. Again, it's the Lord that is calling the shots here. And then the last and the third thing in this chapter that I believe that Paul is correcting regarding misunderstanding in the Lord's work is not only that the Lord's work involves waging a spiritual warfare and using spiritual authority properly, but how do we measure spiritual ministry as to what is successful and what is unsuccessful? How do we measure that? He begins to deal with that in verse 12. We dare not make ourselves of the number or compare ourselves with some that commend themselves, that speak well of themselves, but they measuring themselves by themselves, comparing themselves among themselves, aren't wise. We don't boast of things without our measure, but according to the measure of the rule which God hath distributed to us, a measure to reach even unto you. In other words, when it comes to measuring the success of spiritual ministry, it's not a human estimation of God's people or of God's work. It's a different estimation altogether. In fact, you can see that contrast in chapter 2 and 3 of the book of Revelation. There are seven churches that are addressed by the Lord in those chapters. And in almost, not all, but in almost every case, you have a human estimation of the church, and then you have the Lord's estimation of the church. For example, the last one, the church at Laodicea, they thought that they were rich. They thought that they were wise. They thought that they were doing well. And Jesus comes, and his evaluation of them is totally different. You're naked. You're poor. You're a mess. And they had a total different thinking of themselves. And so if it's God's work, it really has the stamp of the miraculous upon it. How do you measure that? How do you measure the miraculous? Not by statistics, because quantity does not equal quality. And so he says in verse 12, here is a false measure of the Lord's work. These Jewish legalists were big in measuring ministry because they focused on externals that is actually easy to measure. But you know what's hard to measure? The internal transformation of a life. You know, recently, I was praying with some people, and I was listening to their prayers, and I was thinking, Lord, you have really been working in these people's lives. This is just amazing to me. You're at work in their lives. Listen to them pray. Listen how they pray, Lord. That's your doing. That's your working. And it just, it encouraged my heart greatly because I realized, these people are for real. These people aren't just saying words. They're crying out of their hearts, and the things that they're crying out from their hearts is the kind of stuff that means they want God and they want to see God work. That's a hard thing to measure, but there are ways in which it comes out. These people weren't measuring right. They weren't using the right measuring tools. the legalists, they would measure by what you do or what you don't do, but they weren't not able to really look in the heart. God does that. So legalists use the wrong measure. They measure, he says, among themselves. Reminds me of some of our kids have growth charts for their children. Maybe it's something that they stick up on the wall, and they put their child, you know, they put their child back up against the wall, and they measure how tall he or she is at that point. And then maybe 6 months later, you see, oh, they've grown just a little bit, or they've grown a lot. A kid's growth chart had slipped from the wall in the playroom because the tape on the corners that were holding it up had become dry and brittle. And so 4-year-old Jordan, he hung it up again, and he was very careful to make sure that it was straight. And then he stood his little sister, 3-year-old sister, up against the wall to measure her height. And he was so impressed, he cried out, "Mom, Annie's 40 inches tall. I measured her." Mom said, "That's impossible. She's only 3 years old. Let's go see." So, as she suspected, the thing was back on the wall, but while it was hung straight, it wasn't hung at the right height. And so as a result, it was several inches lower than it had been. And so little Annie looked like she had grown tremendously. You know, we, I think, easily make the same mistake in spiritual growth, engaging our spirituality, or engaging our importance. Compared to a shortened scale, we may appear to be a lot better than we are. It's only when we stand against the cross. It's only when we stand before that great leveler of man, which is the cross, that we don't think of ourselves more highly than we ought to think. Because Jesus himself becomes the standard, and he perfectly measures up. And when you're in Christ, you can measure up. When you depend upon the Lord, that's the only way you can measure up. That's the only right measurement, the true measurement. In verses 13 to 18, we really have a true measure of spiritual ministry, of the Lord's work. And I want to share them with you quickly, because there are three questions that he asks here to measure God's work. Are you involved in God's work? You want to find out whether the Lord really approves of it or not? Here's some questions that you need to ask then. In verse 13, he says, "We will not boast of things without our measure, but according to the measure of the rule which God hath distributed, a measure to reach even unto you. For we stretch not ourselves beyond our measure, as though we reach not unto you. For we are come as far as to you also, and preach you the gospel of Christ." You know what he's talking about there? He's talking about being in God's work in the place that God has called you and placed you. You want to measure the true measurement of the work of the Lord? Are you in the place that God wants you to be? Are you where God wants you? You see, these legalists, they didn't start the church in Corinth. The Apostle Paul did. They weren't church planters. They weren't church starters. They were sheep stealers. Like the cults, they would come in and they would take new converts and try to sift them off. God assigned a field to work in. And Paul was a pioneer Gentile preacher or church planter. And he says, "I'm not in competition with anyone. I'm in competition with myself. I'm not measuring myself with that guy in the next region. I'm measuring myself against myself. I am measuring based upon the gifts that the Lord gives me, the opportunities that he has opened to me in the place where he has put me. You want a measure of God's work and the success of it that you're involved in? Are you where God wants you to be? And then a second measure, verses 15 to 17, not boasting of things without our measure, that is, of other men's labors, but having hope when your faith is increased, that we shall be enlarged by you according to our rule abundantly, to preach the gospel in regions beyond you, and not boast of another man's line of things made ready to our hand. But he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord. The second measure that is an accurate measure of being in the Lord's work is not only place, but what I call purpose. Is God glorified through your ministry, through your work for the Lord, your work, you and the Lord's work? Is God glorified? Paul is only claiming what God did through him, the work that God did through him. And when you only claim the work that God does through you, then God gets all the glory for it and not you. What he's saying here is rather sarcastic. I don't know if you've realized that about the apostle. He's very sarcastic at times. And what he's saying is this. He said, you know what? I would have loved to already have been gone to other regions to preach the gospel. But because of the problems I have to deal with you, I'm held back. I'm hindered. But I'm going to boast only in what God does in and through me. So what's the purpose of the Lord's work that you're involved in? Is it for God's glory? Let him the glory of glory in the Lord. That's a quote, right, from Jeremiah 9. Let him that glory, let him that boasts, boast in the Lord. In the work of God that you're involved in, is that your desire, that God gets the glory, or would you like a little bit of it? Do you give him all the glory? There's a third, I think, true measure of the Lord's work. And here it is in the 18th verse. For not he that commendeth himself is approved, but whom the Lord commendeth. And I call that praise. Whom the Lord praises, whom the Lord commends. You know, you can praise yourself. You can commend yourself. Or other people can commend you or praise you. And at the same time, never get God's praise. Which do you want more than anything? You want to lift up yourself? You want others to lift you up? Or do you want God to say, well done? You see, that's the thing. The real test is this. It's not he that commendeth himself that is approved, but whom the Lord commendeth. See the word approved there? It means testing. That's what God does in our lives and in the Lord's work that we're involved in. He allows difficulties to enter into our work of the Lord to test our work. And it has to do with the testing of precious metals. They were put through a process where they were purified, where the dross and the impurities were burned out of them. And that's what he's saying here. The way that God commends the work of the Lord that we're involved in is he allows us to be put into that process of purification. He puts us in that crucible and turns the heat up so that the pride and the self-life can be burned off so that we do glory in the Lord. So it's God's measure and not us or someone else measuring us and praising us and glorifying us. So, the real measure of being in the Lord's work and having God's approval is this: be in the place where God wants you, doing what God wants you to do, so that he is glorified. And when it's all said and done, you'll stand before him one day and you'll hear him say, "Well done." And that will be reward enough. Someone, I think it was Adoniram Judson, who was a famous American missionary long ago to what was then the country of Burma. Here's what he said: a life once spent is irrevocable. It will remain to be contemplated through eternity. The same may be said of each day. When it is once past, it is gone forever. All the marks which we put upon it, it will exhibit forever. Each day will not only be a witness of our conduct, but will affect our everlasting destiny. How shall we then wish to see each day marked with usefulness? It is too late to mend the days that are past. The future is in our power. Let us then each morning resolve to send the day into eternity in such a clothing as we shall wish to wear forever. And at night, let us reflect that one more day is irrevocably gone, indelibly marked. Live day by day with that realization, with that desire, with that resolve, with that trust in the Lord, with that looking to him and depending upon him. And at the end of it all, when you stand in eternity, you'll have the great joy of hearing from the lips of the greatest person in all of the universe, the one that he made for himself, you that he made for himself, say, "Well done. You're a good and faithful servant." And I'm telling you, regardless of any crowns that have been won, that will be reward enough. To hear from the lips of our dear Savior, "I'm proud of you. You've done well." And it's not based upon you comparing yourself with any other spiritual giant. It's just being true to the opportunity and the abilities that God gives you as an individual, regardless of who you are, what your level of education is, whatever your skill set is. Just be faithful to God and depend upon his power, and you'll hear, "Well done." And that's my goal, and that ought to be our goal. I'm sure there are people here that that's all you're living for. Our Father, this is the Lord's work. It's serious, because it's not a play. It's not a game. It's a real war. And Satan, he wants to deceive. He wants to distract. He would love to just destroy the church and believers.